Looks like we've got another one, Stonehouse.
Let me see.
Do you think it's him again?
I'm not sure.
This just in. Several film students from Washington Township have been reported missing.
Frantic search for the students.
Another report of kidnapping similar to those we've seen earlier this month.
What the?
What's going on?
Where are we?
A studio?
Look, there's a camera.
Hello? Is anybody there? Hello?
Kelly, that type of camera doesn't have sound.
How could you wake up in a room and not know where you are?
We must have been kidnapped!
Kelly, it's okay.
Look!
Mr. Beagle! Guys, quit crying and let's do something about it.
Lynn! Listen.
Hello, Rewinders. I'd like to play a game. I trust you're all wondering where you are. I can assure you, while the location is not important, what this room has to offer is important. Salvation, if you earn it. Throughout the past few years, you've made a living filming others. Now it is your turn to be filmed. In this studio, there are 10 cameras. You must document a series of events, but you only have a month to do it. Miss the deadline, and you will suffer the consequences. Let the games begin.
Hey Township,
I'm Nikki.
And I'm Kelsey. We have your October edition of Month of Rewind Season 15.
Saving lives one point at a time, Danielle Regrosa reports on Township students coming together for the annual Red Cross Blood Drive.
The students here at WTHS are very conscious of the world around them. Each year when the Red Cross hosts their fall blood drive, many students come out and show their support for those in need by donating blood. Each fall, the American Red Cross comes to WTHS to collect students' blood. Students who are 16 and meet a certain height and weight requirement or are 17 and older are permitted to give blood. On the day of the blood drive, students are given an appointment pass to donate. Our Interact Club hosts the blood drive and gets the students involved.
I'm the chair from Interact for the fall blood drive, and setting it up, it wasn't a lot of hard work, but you kind of just had to get it organized and try and get a lot of people signed up. A lot of people couldn't give blood, but once everybody got their papers turned in, we just scheduled them and got their passes in their homeroom teachers' mailboxes, and that's pretty much it.
The Red Cross members that come to the high school hope to give the students a good experience.
It is better. What you do is you get the donors before they ever donated before. So if you give them a good experience, you know they'll be repeated donors.
Because of the enthusiasm of the Red Cross faculty, first-time donators had a great experience.
The Red Cross people were pretty good about it. I'm a worrywart, so I kind of asked a lot of questions. But they helped to answer a lot of my questions, and they relieved the worries that I had, so I went into it very calm.
The skill and compassion of the Red Cross keeps older students coming back.
Well, I thought it was really nice to give blood. I mean, I'm mostly a seasonal donor, so I donate all the time. But through Interact, it was really nice that we could organize something so wide in the school, and a lot of people came and showed up. It was really nice.
Students at WTHS enjoy donating blood for various reasons.
I decided to give blood because I do it every year, and it helps save people's lives, and I always want to help someone out, so.
Because it doesn't really take like it's something bad for me. There's no negative side to me doing it, and it does help save three lives. So, why not, and it's a good thing.
I spoke to a Red Cross member on why she got involved in the blood collection process.
I had a son that passed away. So while he was alive, he needed blood products. So right after he passed away, I went back to school to be a phlebotomist and started working here.
The enthusiasm of the Red Cross members inspires Township students who would like to pursue careers in nursing or in blood collection.
Well, I wasn't able to give blood because I'm too tiny, but I wanted to be part of it because I never get to do anything like with blood, so it was interesting, and I want to be a nurse, so it was a good experience just to get to know what's going on, so it was fun. I'm glad I got to help other people out while not getting blood. So.
Overall, this year's Fall Blood Drive was a huge success thanks to the generosity of Township students. The Red Cross thanks WTHS for their support and hopes to see everyone next fall. This has been Danielle DeGrosso reporting for Monthly Rewind Season 15.
12 Township senior girls have been chosen for the homecoming court this year. Allie Gallo introduces us to them.
Throughout all of high school, the one thing students here at Washington Township look forward to in their senior year is homecoming. At the beginning of the month, the 12 most well-rounded girls of the senior class of 2011 were chosen by their classmates. During the rest of the month of October, these girls have had the opportunity to represent their class as the Washington Township High School 2010 homecoming court. On Friday, September 17th, the seniors at WTHS voted for two girls they felt represented their class the best. For the next week, student council advisors Mrs. Longo and Mrs. Muselli counted every vote.
Counting the votes for me isn't really stressful since I've done it a few years in a row now, but it's exciting because I can't wait to find out who the class nominated.
On Friday, September 24th, during the first 5 minutes of first period, the 12 girls with the most votes were announced. They were honored with a sash and a tiara in front of their entire class. Let's take a look at the Washington Township High School class of 2011 homecoming court. Move your hips, do your thing, get off the wall, don't matter what they think, from your fingertips to your toes, you know you have, so let everybody know, gotta take it low, to the floor, from the hills to the streets of the ghetto, hips don't lie, so move them up, we ain't gonna stop, till we see everybody's bottoms up, bottoms up, bottoms up. The girls reminisce on their memories of where they were the morning they were crowned.
I was in the gym, and there was like four of us girls. It was me, Alex, Carly, and Rosemary, and we were all like together, and we were like so nervous and everything. So, and then we were really excited, and everyone came in and gave us crowns and our sashes.
I was in first period in pre-calc, and I was taking a test, and I wrote it, like they said, oh, we'll say in alphabetical order, and I was just like writing, and they're like, Smith on there, and I was just like a deer in headlights, and then three kids walked in, like, gave me the sash and crayon, and I was trying to get all my books, and I was shaking, and everything's falling, and then I had to get everything and go down to see all the girls.
The girls couldn't have been happier with such an honor.
Yes, I was so excited. I was nervous. I started shaking. I left my folder there. I left everything in the room that we were supposed to bring with us, and I was, like, shaking and sweating. It was pretty scary.
I was so excited, and I was nervous and shaky.
Well, Joey and my sister crowned me, so it choked me up a little bit, not gonna lie. It was really cute. It made me really happy.
As soon as the girls were crowned, they had to report to a meeting to get all of their information. The next month was going to be filled with everything homecoming. The first thing to do was pick an escort. All of the girls had their own special reasons as to why they picked who they did, and the escorts all had their own reactions once they were asked.
She didn't really ask me, like, we kinda had a deal from like a while ago if this ever happened, so I don't know.
I was really happy when Rosemary asked me to be her escort because I know Sam is her escort too, and we're both splitting time because he plays football. So I'm really glad I could help her out and just be a part of the homecoming court with her.
Next came the dance practices. The 12 girls and their escorts are going to be performing a dance three times: at the school's pep rally, the homecoming dance, and the spirit parade at the homecoming game. Homecoming court nominee and student council member Alexander Richards is the choreographer for this dance. She also had help from the other homecoming girls, Zoe Miller and Mary Hearn. The practices are a process that have taken a lot of patience.
Slow, which I expected, but I'm just waiting for everyone to get used to the moves. It's gonna take some time with the music and everything, but I think it's gonna come together really good as long as everyone's working really hard.
Learning the dance is a whole new experience for the girls and their escorts, and they're having a difficult time getting used to something that is so new to them.
I like it. I just don't know if everyone likes watching me. I'm really bad at it, but whatever, they can suffer.
Dancing, it's fun. There's fun guys out there.
I mean, it's time for like people to break out of their shell a little.
I really do like dancing with my escort, Rosemi, because it's kind of fun, and I like learning from Alex and Zoe because they're really good teachers.
However the dance may be difficult to most, they're having an amazing time making new friends this month.
Yeah, there's some people in the homecoming court who I've never met ever, so this is pretty cool. I mean, it gives me an opportunity to meet new people, which is awesome. So.
Some people. I mostly know everyone, though. But like, I'm making better friends with the people that I didn't really talk to that much. Yeah, I'm having a blast.
All of the preparation comes down to one night. The homecoming game will be on Friday, October 29th. The girls and their escorts will perform the dance at the Spear Parade before the game, and the winner will be crowned during halftime. The girls are all anxious for what's to come.
I'm really excited for the game. It's going to be really nerve-wracking. Well, I'm probably going to be more nervous then, just trying to, you know, relax. I'm not really thinking about that yet, but I guess I'll be nervous the night of.
Yeah, I mean, there's going to be a lot of people watching, so I mean, but I'm excited for it, so.
The past month has been a once-in-a-lifetime experience for the 12 homecoming nominees, one that they will look back on with great memories.
So overall experience is incredibly just really, I don't even know, it just gives me the biggest adrenaline rush, and I wrote a song about it, and it's just, it's definitely a big part of me, like, in high school, so.
It's awesome. It's probably my favorite high school memory. So, yeah, it's awesome.
Yes, it's probably my top experience of high school. Definitely top five. Top two. Maybe number one. I don't know. We'll see.
For the homecoming girls, this past month has been a perfect way to start off their senior year. Although it has been a busy month, it will be one they will never forget. These 12 girls have given so much to WTHS over the past 4 years. We congratulate you for all of your hard work and accomplishments throughout all of high school. Tune in next month to see who was crowned as the Washington Township High School 2010 Homecoming Queen. This is Allie Gallo reporting for Month 31, Season 15.
Kira Parkin is a well-rounded student here at WTHS. Carol Amina tells us more about her high school journey.
Some say that high school is just a phase, or a minor part of our lives. But for Kira Parkin, high school will be something she can look back on and smile. The first day Kira walked through the doors of WTHS, she knew exactly who she wanted to be for the next 4 years. To become this person, she got involved immediately and started making new, lifelong friends. These friends, her family, and her teachers could not be more proud of the young woman she has become, and they all know Kira is someone they can depend on. Although she has just begun, Kira knows the end to her senior year and high school will come too fast. So while she has time, she is keeping busy and soaking up every aspect of being a senior at WTHS. Kira started her first day freshman year, knowing that who she was in high school would greatly influence the person she became later in life. Realizing this, right off the bat, she got involved and soaked up every second of her time in high school.
I first went in and watching the morning announcements, I had so much to choose from, so many people I wanted to meet. So even it was awesome starting field hockey in the summer because I could see all the girls coming down the hallway waving to me, and I like felt like I was a part of something finally. So then I started joining clubs, and I wanted to try out to see what I liked the best. I didn't really know what I liked, so it was really important for me to start getting involved and like right away my freshman year.
Kira is not only respected by her peers, but also by the adults in her life. Her teachers are astounded by her achievements in the classroom, and her club advisors know they can always count on her to help them out.
Kira Parkin's been in student council since she was a sophomore, and she's always been one of the most dedicated members. She is very responsible, she's organized, she knows how to take charge when she needs to, and she's just a great person. She's beautiful inside and out.
I think Kira's a very enthusiastic student. She's hardworking. She always pays attention to detail, and she likes to get involved in everything in the classroom and be one of those people who talks to everyone, and she's just a lot of fun to have in class.
Being involved in Student Council, Interact, French Honor Society, working at Dunkin' Donuts, and volunteering at the hospital keeps Kira very busy. However, she realizes the importance of social life at Township and tries her best to attend sporting events and other after-school activities as much as possible.
My day is very, very hectic. I'm at school. From school, I either am staying after straight to work for hours, but managing my time is probably one of the most important aspects because I still have time for a social life. I still have time to go out with my friends, still have time to socialize with other people, go out with my family.
Life is nothing unless you have friends to share it with. Living by this motto, Kira tries to be a friend to all and is always there to help others out.
Me and Kira have been friends since like eighth grade, and she's always there for me, like whenever I need to talk to her about something. And like, it helps that she lives right around the corner, and whenever I need to tell her something, like I'll just walk over there, or she'll walk over here, or like meet us halfway, and like I'll just tell her whatever's going on, like if I have a problem or if she has a problem, we just are always there for each other.
Kira's very dependable, and she's loyal, and she never lies to me, and she's a really nice girl, and she's fun to hang out with.
Kira's family is always behind her 110%. From being a star on the field hockey team freshman year to recently being inducted into French Honor Society, they are overjoyed with all she's been able to accomplish over the past 4 years.
I'm really proud of Kira. You know, originally I was concerned about her going to township with all the kids, but I have to say she's really made the most of it. She's really determined, and she's into a lot of things, and she's really made the most of it, and I'm really happy about that.
Kira is a model for the younger generations of Washington Township. She's an outstanding big sister and is always willing to lend advice to younger kids.
She like always gives me really good advice when I need it, and like she's like a hero to me because she's like, I don't know what I would do if I like didn't have her.
She took advantage of high school a lot, and that's something I would like to do next year when I go into high school, and I kind of look up to her and I want to be able to be like her when I get into high school and be a lot involved with like all the activities.
Graduating with the class of 2011 will be a great honor for Kira. And although she can't wait, her parents aren't quite ready. Both her mom and dad are excited for Kira and want the best for her. But at the same time, they know how empty the house is going to feel without her in it.
I think she's going to do really well. And we'll keep in touch with her. And we've been through this with our other boys, so I think it'll be fine.
Not quite ready for that big step yet. I'm hoping that Kira, you know, gets into a school that she loves. I think she deserves to get into her number one choices. I'm not quite ready for her to leave the nest yet. I think I'm going to be one of those hovering mothers that call every day and send packages of cookies. But I think she's going to do really well, and I'm really, really excited for her.
It's amazing how quick 4 years can go by. Everyone always says, enjoy high school. It ends too soon. It's a shame that most don't realize that until it's over. Kira plans on living it up for the next 8 months with her friends and family before she heads off to college. Although she's preparing to move on to the next step in life, Washington Township will always remain a part of who she is. As she ends this chapter in her life, Kira moves on to the next, remembering that they call graduation ceremonies commencement exercises because it's not the end, it is merely the beginning. This is Kara Lamena reporting to you for Monthly Rewind Season 15.
Township students unite one Friday every month to put on their fanciest clothes. Carly Maddox reports on Fresh Friday.
One of the newest of many traditions here at WTHS is Fresh Friday. Fresh Friday is held on the first Friday of every month where students dress to impress. Fresh Friday started last year and was a great success, so the founders Carly Bove and Ryan Francisco decided to continue with this tradition.
The first Friday of every month is called Fresh Friday. And on those days, girls, I'd like you to wear a skirt, a dress. For the guys, you could wear a nice tie, a vest, a dress shirt. And the goal is for a whole school to look fresh, be fresh, so get fresh.
This new event has given the student body at WTHS the opportunity to get together and show their township pride by dressing extra fresh. Friday, October 1st was the first Fresh Friday of the 2010-2011 school year. Students roamed the halls and attended class just like every other day in township. The only difference, however, was their appearance. The majority of the student body dressed fresh on this Friday. Girls wore skirts and dresses, while guys wore a dress shirt and tie. Sadly, everyone woke up to a cold and rainy day on the morning of October 1st. This inclement weather prohibited some students from participating in this event.
For Fresh Friday, I didn't participate because I'm a freshman and I really didn't know what to expect. It was really yucky out and gross, and I just wanted to really have a bum day.
I did not participate in Fresh Friday because, if I remember, it was really gross that day. But if I did and the weather was different, I'd probably participate because it's always nice to look good and impress people every now and then.
However, this poor weather did not stop over the 400 other participating students.
Of course I participated. Why wouldn't you want to get dressed up? I mean, it's fun. Nowhere else to wear my heels. So, and it's just nice. I mean, like, everyone looks nice and everyone likes to take pictures, and it's our senior year, so gotta embrace absolutely everything.
I participated in Fresh Friday. Like, even though, like, I'm a sophomore, everyone looked real cute and I really liked it.
Fresh, I'll be fresh all day. Yeah, yeah. Silver dollar, fresh, I'll be
fresh, always Tell my dollar fresh, I stay I'll be fresh, all day
This new and interesting tradition all began last year during the student council elections. Fresh Friday played a huge part in the campaign of our new student council president and vice president, Ryan Francisco and Carly Boob. Ryan and Carly thought of this idea during the student council elections last year, where the students showed their support by participating in the weekly Fresh Friday. Together, they created a tradition that the students of WTHS can enjoy.
I think the most important thing about Fresh Friday is that everybody can be unique about how fresh they are. Kind of nice to come to school, everybody dressed up.
To see everybody get together and see who is gonna run for us, so that was the whole point of it, but. And I guess just it was just like a nice idea just to have everybody get dressed up for one, so.
Not only the students enjoy the idea of Fresh Friday, but the teachers as well.
I think it's an outstanding idea. It's really cool to see the kids all dressed up. Kind of helps change the atmosphere in the hallways. I think the kids are more sedate because they're all dressed up and they look nice and fresh.
The outcome of the first Fresh Friday definitely exceeded all expectations.
A lot of people have done it, so I'm actually really surprised. I didn't think people were going to continue with it this year, so I'm actually really happy with the outcome.
It's getting pretty big. I mean, a lot of kids ask me about it, but I just like the feeling that everybody gets dressed, so I feel really good about it. I'm glad that Carly and I could bring it to the whole school, so pretty happy about it.
Carly and Ryan hope that Fresh Friday continues in the many years to come.
It's really special to Ryan and I, and we hope to continue it through, like, the next couple years, somebody keep our legacy, so.
Fresh Friday is a great way to show how the students of WTHS have great pride and unify as one. Most students are very excited and eager to participate while others are not. All in all, the goal of Ryan Francisco and Carly Bove was achieved. Fresh Friday is definitely a tradition that will stick around the halls of Washington Township in the years to come. Look fresh, be fresh, so get fresh. This is Carly Maddox reporting for Monthly Rewind Season 15.
Philadelphia sports are at its all-time high. DJ Mark tells us more about the Flyers.
October, an exciting time for local sports fans. A season coming to an end with some postseason magic. A season already in stride on a football field. And a season about to get underway on the ice. This October, the Philadelphia Flyers began another season in the National Hockey League. As always, expectations are very high for the team. Monthly Rewind recently had a chance to talk to some students and staff of Washington Township High School to see what they think about the return of the orange and black. Last year, the Flyers took the Delaware Valley on a thrill ride through the Stanley Cup playoffs.
Roaring on in is Jokinen. The deep, the save by Boucher, and the Flyers are going to the playoffs!
And I remember that was probably the craziest event that I've ever been to in the city of Philadelphia.
That I remember watching that game when they won in the shootout, which was amazing because they couldn't win a shootout all during the regular season.
After clinching the seventh seed on the final day of the regular season against the New York Rangers, the Flyers knocked off the New Jersey Devils in the first round in five games, behind stellar goaltending from Brian Boucher. In the second round, after going down 3-0 to the Boston Bruins, the Flyers pulled off the great comeback, winning four straight games to win the series.
I think it's one of the best comebacks in Philadelphia sports history, so I thoroughly enjoyed the comeback against Boston.
Unbelievable. Just knowing that they were, you know, they could finally make it, especially being the underdogs that they were, and coming over, you know, all the things that they had to deal with the goalies and, you know, the lack of certain players not playing. And
blaming their first Eastern Conference championship since 1997, the Flyers took on the Chicago Blackhawks for the Stanley Cup. An unfortunate play led to the Blackhawks winning the Cup and the Flyers' Cinderella run coming to an end.
And I think even when they lost to the Blackhawks, nobody got mad at them because we had so much respect for everything they put into it. So just the fact that they were a team that literally was on the brink of elimination to make it to the final was really an exciting ride.
Now, after 3 months of waiting, the Flyers take to the ice again to begin another season. Many stars, new and old, as well as rookies, made an impressive impact on the coaching staff and the fans. 22-year-old rookie goaltender Sergei Bobrovsky led Flyers goaltending in playing time, record, and goals against average. Bobrovsky instantly became the talk of the town amongst Flyers fans.
I think Bobrovsky is surprising so far. It's hard to tell as of right now, but if he keeps this up, I'm really liking our future with our goaltending.
He is looking like a great goaltender, and he, in my opinion, should be our starter.
Hopefully he's the real deal, because goaltending always seems to be the question for the Flyers. So if he comes up big, who knows what they could do.
The Flyers open the season in Pittsburgh at the new Consol Energy Center on October 7th with a 3-2 win behind great play from Bobrovsky, who made 29 saves in his NHL debut. In the first game of the year for Chris Pronger, the Flyers scored 4 goals en route to a 4-2 win. The season may have just begun, but it promises to be another exciting and promising season. And hopefully, the Flyers can make another deep run for Lord Stanley's Cup. For Monthly Rewind Season 15, I'm DJ Mark.
Christine Siaco introduces us to Senora Belisario, a Spanish teacher here at Washington Township High School.
When I asked students around the school who they would want to see for their next Rewind teacher feature, one name kept coming up. Mrs. Joanna Belisario is a Spanish teacher here at the high school and is loved by many. During my interview with Mrs. Belisario, I was able to learn more about her journey from her initial love of foreign language to her love of teaching Spanish today. Mrs. Belisario attended Wildwood Catholic High School, Westchester University, Rowan University, and the College of New Jersey. She did not know that she wanted to be a Spanish teacher, but always loved Spanish. She tells me about the different levels of Spanish she is teaching this year.
This year I have advanced Spanish and intermediate to Spanish. I love to teach all levels. I am enjoying the advanced level this year because I can speak more Spanish in the classroom and get more Spanish back from the students.
Mrs. Belisario talked to me about how frustrating it is to learn a new language and how she keeps class interesting and fun for her students.
To keep class interesting, I like to vary the activities, and I think that makes it interesting. We're not doing the same thing all the time. I do like the cultural activities. I think they're most interesting to students, where we're not necessarily doing grammar, but more culture.
Why did the kids connect with her so easily? I talked with some of her students to find out.
She's always like happy to be here and always is peppy, so whenever like we learn something new, she does it in a good way. She's so funny and she loves to teach and she loves all her students.
Ms. Belisario is really friendly and she'll talk to you about anything and really help you with any problems that you're having. She's just really funny and she's a really great teacher and she loves what she does.
Inside and outside the classroom, Mrs. Belisario has impacted many students' lives. I spoke with some students to find out more.
Ms. Belisario greatly impacted my life because she showed me that as long as I studied, I could pass one of my hardest classes.
She's made a big impact on me because I'll probably continue Spanish in high school and probably college thanks to her.
Mrs. Belisario has something rare to find in a teacher, and that's the power to keep her students interested in the subject and craving more. Students look forward to coming to her class every day, and it's evident that Mrs. Belisario loves what she does. Thank you, Mrs. Belisario, for your dedication and commitment to the students here at Washington Township High School. This has been Christine Siaco reporting for Monthly Rewind, Season 15.
Football is a huge part of Washington Township. Erica Appel tells us about the combining of the Minutemen and the Patriots.
Here at the Washington Township High School, we are known for our Washington Township Minutemen. What many people don't realize is that they were never just the Minutemen. The Minutemen and the Patriots have built a solid rivalry, but in the end, they all come together as one and form the Washington Township High School team, the Minutemen.
Greg Lomax, head coach of the 70-pounded Minutemen, tells a little about the rivalry between the Minutemen and the Patriots.
The little Minutemen, the little Patriots, there is a rivalry that develops. The kids know each other. It's the first time they really get to play against other kids in the town at the same age.
Coach Lomax tells what he thinks as these little players grow up.
I found having older kids in the system, one about ready to go to high school, that the kids, as they get older, the difference between Minutemen and Patriot really disappears. The Patriots and Minutemen certainly like to beat each other, but it's not as the rivalry is not as acute as it was when the kids were little.
Chase Lomax, player of the 70-pounder Minutemen, lets us know how he feels when he plays the Patriots.
I feel so good when I play the Patriots because they're my friends.
If the Minutemen are in red,
Who are these people in blue?
Charlie Dowd, head coach of the 70-pounder Patriots, tells us about the rivalry between the Patriots and the Minutemen.
As far as the rivalry, I think that's more talked about than in actuality, because it's a nice rivalry. We like to have fun with it, but we also remind the kids also, since the kids go to school together, and the kids hang out together, they're best friends, but we make sure they know that there's a competitive balance, and I think it actually helps to make them better friends off the field.
Mark Colligan, player of the 70-pounder Patriots, tells us what he likes to do as a Patriot and why.
I want to beat the Minutemen because all my friends are on that team.
Robert Neuber, coach of the Washington Township High School freshman team, tells us, even though they are one team, there is still some sort of rivalry between
them. There's always a rivalry between the Minutemen and the Patriots, starting at a very young age. And you know, when they're growing up and they're as young as they are, they know that they're competing against friends and so forth. And we always talk about, you know, Minutemen. Since I was a Minutemen coach the majority of the time, Minutemen were always starters. Patriots had to earn their way up.
Danny Giangiulio, player of the Minutemen, tells us what he thought of this rivalry.
And having the Patriots there beside us in the same complex practicing, it felt like it was more contention between us, and I always wanted to kill the Patriots.
How did Danny feel coming in as a freshman and being one team?
Coming in the freshman year, I was excited because I knew both teams had very good, skillful players and that we were going to be a dominant freshman team.
Isaac Eggezy tells us what he looks forward to when he was a Patriot.
Definitely the Mayor's Cup, because that was like the bragging rights of the entire season. We'd play them. I remember the one year when I was on the 85s, Coach Chris would always give us a nice motivation speech before the game and tell us if we didn't win, the rest of our season was junk.
Eggezy tells us how it was coming in as a freshman and being on one team.
Well, it was a lot better this year because I already knew a lot of the people that were playing, from people who played spring and stuff. So I mostly knew everyone, and it was kind of like there was no Minutemen and Patriots. We were all just one.
The Reds and the Blues have clashed for years, but the teams are now together as one. The rivalry has lasted between the Patriots and the Minutemen for years. However, the traditions and hopes of the games will continue to be as exciting as they were, but only with one difference. They are the Washington Township Minutemen. This is Erica Appel reporting with Monthly Rewind, Season 15.
I love being a Patriots.
I like being a Washington Township Minutemen.
What better to do on a beautiful fall day than help out at the Community Buddy Walk? Laura Wayan tells us more.
Every year, many gather to raise awareness for Down syndrome. You may have heard of the Buddy Walk. It's a one-mile walk that many families and volunteers get to participate in. The Interact Club and Mrs. Naval joined the Buds organization to prepare for this event. They all meet at the park at 7:30 a.m. for an event that starts at 10 a.m. With weeks of planning and hours of setting up, they managed to make a fun-filled day for all the families and kids. Despite the cold weather and the early time, many volunteers came out to help set up all of the tables, prize baskets, food, and all of the different events of the Buddy Walk.
We simply have to get the kids involved. And so we, you know, just have to get kids signed up.
All of the families got to make teams for their loved ones and enjoy a day with the games and many carnival-inspired rides and food.
The Buddy Walk really accentuates the fact that we can have them come out and everything's about them. They're comfortable being there, and we have games and activities that are geared towards them.
It's really great to see all the kids who suffer from Down syndrome come out for the Buddy Walk because they have such a great time and you see them smiling. And that's the number one reason why I love Buddy Walk, is just to see how much fun they can have with all the games and the food and the music.
Although the face paint, food, and activities were fun, the most important part was seeing the happiness that the Buddy Walk brought to the kids.
It's not only a day to raise money and awareness for kids with Down syndrome, but it's also to celebrate them and their different personalities. And it's great that they get out and they can meet new kids and meet kids like them, and it's a lot of fun.
And it's one of the few events in the school where you get to work hands-on with people, and it's just a great day. I mean, you come out and you do activities with them. You know, we all eat and we do the walk around the park.
Just important for everybody to give back to the community, to feel good about yourself, and so this is a good way to do it because it's a fun way to give back.
With a band at the start to get everyone excited, everyone lined up for the Buddy Walk. With a line of over 1,800 green shirts showing the support, you got to see just how many people this event got together.
You've got a friend in me. You've got
with 11 successful years, come out next year to support the Buddy Walk and the National Down Syndrome Society. Until next month, this has been Laura Wayne reporting from Month 3 Rewind, Season 15.
October is a month filled with fright. Johnny DeGabriel takes us to one of the scariest places around, the East State Penitentiary.
Scare you? Imagine experiencing that in person. Where is this, you might ask? At the Eastern State Penitentiary in Philadelphia, one of the most famous penitentiaries in the world. Founded in 1829, this place has served as a penitentiary for over 142 years, incarcerating famous criminals such as gangster Al Capone, bank robber Willie Sutton, and more. But since 1994, the penitentiary has been used for historical tours, prison exhibits, and of course, the terror behind the walls, haunted tours. With Halloween in close proximity, the Eastern State Penitentiary has been a major hotspot for families and friends. The terror behind the walls serves as the main attraction and gives guests plenty of opportunities to scream at the top of their lungs. The scare begins right when the guests arrive. Ghostly guards, prisoners, and other interesting people are there to meet them and give them a warm welcome to the penitentiary. But when it's time to go on the haunted tour, that's when the real fright begins. Guests go through six attractions in the penitentiary, including Night Watch, the Lockdown, the Infirmary, and more. And along the way, meet up with some terrifying-looking criminals and figures who are out to scare them. Walking through cell blocks, glow-in-the-dark attractions, and pitch-black rooms, guests get the real eerie effect of being in the penitentiary. But what was the scariest part to them? What made the haunted experience so scary?
So there was this attraction called the Experiment, where it's glow in the dark, and you wear these 3D glasses, and there's people popping out of doors. They're wearing the same thing as the wall, and they just jump at you.
The scariest part for me was maybe during the 3D part where the spider comes out from the roof. That's just about it.
That is the scariest thing I've ever gone through, okay? As of right now, we don't know in the future, but it's worth it. I mean, people just came at you. They didn't care. They acted. They did their part. They looked scary. One dude was walking around with a heart. And his eye was just falling out. And the other girl, her face was just all nasty. And yeah, she's like, you'll be my dinner. And she got all into it. Oh, it was great. It was awesome. I loved it.
For guests, the whole experience seems to be terrifying and fun at the same time. But what is the funnest part for the staff of the penitentiary?
I would say sometimes seeing people get chased all the way down the sidewalk just running for their lives, even especially if they were you don't scare me, and then next thing you know, all it takes is one shot, and they're just out like a cannonball, just down the whole sidewalk. And the other part is seeing some of the people who were so scared going in, on their way in, they're shaking or holding their somebody's arm, I don't want to go in, I don't want to go, and on the way out, they're that was awesome, that was so much fun, can we go back? And you're yes, mission accomplished. That's the most fun part of it, is scaring people but knowing that people are having fun being scared, it feeds off of it.
Scaring people is what makes their job fun, but what makes the staff come back each year is the people that they work with.
I keep coming back for the other people that I work with. It's a really great crew, they really take care of us here. And I have the best assistant zone manager down here on 22nd Street. and he's certainly not behind the camera telling me to say that. And I don't know, that's basically, it's the people. It's a really great staff.
Though it was a scary experience for guests, they had a great time and said they'd come back to the penitentiary again.
I would come back again, definitely. It's very fun. You got to come with a big group of girls and watch them scream. You gotta have one person in the front scaring them, and one of the best ones is they act like something came out and they scream. It's like a sympathetic screamer. It's very fun.
It's a great time. It's not that long. The wait wasn't that long. It's worth it. Well worth it.
Of course.
course. I mean, who doesn't like being scared? I know you get a little, you know, iffy when you're about to go in there and when you get scared. But when you come out, you're like, that was the best thing ever. I want to go back with my friends. Bring more of my friends so they can get scared so you can laugh in their face. It's hilarious. Of course I come back.
MTV's Fears, Ghost Hunters, and Ghost Adventures won't give you the true experience of being down at the penitentiary. So come down to the Eastern State Penitentiary at 22nd and Fairmount Avenue for the true fright experience. This is Johnny DiGabbro reporting for Monthly Rewind, Season 15.
Safety first, Linda Engsel tells us about fire prevention.
As the weather grows colder, many Washington Township residents start turning on their heat and plan to decorate for the holidays. It's a great time to start thinking about fire safety. On the rainy night of October 9th, many Washington Township families came out to the 910 parking lot to learn about fire safety and to keep their families safe this winter. The National Fire Prevention Association official theme for Fire Prevention Night across America this year was Smoke Alarms, a sound you can live with. This campaign is designed to educate people about the importance of smoke alarms and to encourage everyone to take necessary steps to update and maintain their home with smoke alarm protection. Many Washington Township residents already take extra steps to ensure their homes are fire safe. However, they came out to Fire Prevention Night to update safety tips and laws. Parents also want to pass on fire safety advice to their children.
I just think it's great for children to learn the different techniques on how to stop, drop, and roll, and how to put out a fire, and so that's why we come every year.
It gets the kids to know the fire companies, not to be afraid of the men that are helping them, and to make sure that they understand that fire is dangerous.
Washington Township has been hosting fire prevention every October for over 30 years. For many years, each of the stations, Grenlock, Whitman, Herfell, had separate events at each station. However, this is the second year that all three stations came together at the high school to have one large event.
Because this way you can have one night where the entire town comes out, you can have the entire fire department here, and there's more than enough space to do it, and you can have more departments come out.
I think it's good, so because we are really one department, and getting together with my fellow firefighters, my brother firefighters, is a good time.
Firefighters from the three Washington Township stations teamed up with DEFRT to teach local residents fire safety. Firefighters organized different stations for children to visit to learn more about fire safety. Washington Township kids rotated through stations such as the smokehouse, a showcase of different types of trucks and tools inside, and the opportunity to try out different hoses, along with various information sessions. Firefighters are out and about in the community throughout October to teach fire safety lessons. The fire department also went to Grenlock Kindergarten and the six elementary schools during October to teach students who did not have a chance to come out on this night and reinforce the message. Despite the rain, Fire Prevention Night had a great turnout. For those of you who missed out, here are some tips local firefighters recommended. Every family should have a meeting spot. Just in case of an emergency, everybody will know where to go. Monthly fire drills, to know what to do in case of a fire. And lastly, every floor should have at least one smoke detector and one fire extinguisher. Until next month, this has been Linda Engsel reporting for Monthly Rewind, Season 15.
October is Breast Cancer Awareness Month. Molly Molnar fills us in on the field hockey team's efforts to raise awareness for their Play for the Cure game.
Play for the Cure is an event that raises money for the Susan G. Komen Foundation, which is dedicated to improving education and research about causes, treatment, and searching for a cure for breast cancer. As the First Lady Michelle Obama noted, early detection is critical to beating this deadly disease. Breast cancer crosses all demographic lines. It knows no color, no ethnicity, no income. I spoke with members of the team on their thoughts on Play for the Cure.
Great charity. It's a great opportunity for us to do it. We started last year. Mr. Connor presented it to the team, and we really thought it was a good idea. We tried to get into it as much as we could. I felt like this year we were a lot more organized, and we were able to get it across to the rest of the school, and we got a lot more people excited about it and able to participate in it.
A lot of people were wearing the shirts around and kept asking if we had more bracelets to sell, and
everybody just wants to take part in it and be a part of it to show that they care.
On October 16th, 2010, our very own field hockey team took the field to play for the Cure in their annual Think Pink game.
Goal scored by number 23, Lindsay Hatch.
At halftime, all the active supporters for breast cancer awareness, along with their family and friends, gathered on the field to recognize the loved ones who are cured, still fighting, or the ones who lost their lives to this challenging disease. After these individuals were recognized, the WTHS Minute Maids, along with their friends and family, gathered on the field in the formation of a pink ribbon, which is the international symbol of breast cancer awareness. Both teams participated in this event, and there was so much positive energy. I spoke with members of the field hockey team on their thoughts on making the ribbon and the announcement of the names at halftime.
The ribbon during halftime is really important because it brings the fans and the players from both teams and the coaches from both teams together, and it just shows how important the cause is to us. So having my aunt's name announced at halftime is really important to me and my family because it not only honors her memory, but it honors the memory and the fight of people who also have breast cancer.
I had the opportunity to speak with Brianne Waters, varsity goalie, on her thoughts on the turnout of the overall 2010 Pink game.
I think the biggest accomplishment of this Play for the Cure is that not only are we able to, you know, bring about awareness around the school, but we're also to be able to give back to the community through, like, playing field hockey. It's not just about the game. When we play this game, it's about, you know, doing something more and doing something for the community. Everyone on the team, from freshmen to seniors, everyone did their part. You know, everyone had bracelets, ribbons, t-shirts. We were all selling stuff, you know, trying to get as much money as we can.
Overall, the event was surreal. Each and every contribution made a difference to the Susan G. Komen Foundation. Cancer is a beatable, treatable, and survivable disease. Together, we can extinguish cancer one step at a time. Until next month, this has been Molly Molnar reporting for Monthly Rewind Season 15.
The hardest debate between the Washington Township students is who has the harder classes. Nikki Sandelier clears up the confusion and gives us the answer.
Each student at WTHS is required to take and pass basic courses such as math, science, world language, history, and English in order to graduate high school. But not every class is a walk in a park. Every student has a class that they consider harder than the rest.
My hardest subject is Spanish.
AP history.
My hardest subject is chemistry.
Science. Because
this past month, Monthly Rewind ran a poll to discover what subject Township students think is the hardest. Science was named the hardest, closely followed by math. So why do students think science is so difficult?
I just don't understand it.
Because all the formulas and equations just don't work for me. Just can't understand it.
Chemistry teacher Mrs. Hall tells us why she feels students are bad at science and gives us advice to help students achieve success in the lab.
Students have preconceived notions, at least I notice in my class when they come in the very first day. They think that they're bad at science. Me, as a science teacher, I try to bring that sense of curiosity back about how things work and how the world works around you.
Math was also ranked at the top of Township's hardest classes, with only one vote between first and second hardest classes.
My hardest subject is algebra, and it's just like a lot of formulas, and it can get really confusing sometimes for me.
My hardest subject is geometry, because I cannot get the shapes and all to work, and the angles and everything is hard.
Pre-calculus teacher Mr. Guyrishin shares his thoughts about the challenges that occur in the classroom pertaining to math.
I think math is a difficult subject for students because it's something that they actually have to work at and study, whereas it's just not studying facts. The best way for students to improve upon that is by going after school and seeing their teacher. All teachers in the math department are always after school helping students with extra problems.
As far as Township students go, science and math are by far the toughest subjects for students to tackle. Whether you're a freshman or a senior, everyone has their strengths and weaknesses. This is Nikki Sandelier reporting for Monthly Rewind Season 15. Here's Kelly Sharkey with this month's edition of Mail Time.
Township, I'm Kelly Sharkey with another edition of your Rewind Mail Time. Let's take a look at the letter.
My dearest mail time, I love, 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 love Halloween. I wish I could celebrate it every day. What about you? Sincerely, Frank E. Stein.
This is Halloween, this is Halloween, 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 Halloween.
All right, Kelsey Brown.
Here.
Danielle DeGrosa.
Here.
Jess Hagberg.
Here.
Taylor Heil.
Here.
Carly Maddox.
Here.
Molly Molnar's not here. Nicole Sandler's not here. Laura Wayand.
Present.
Okay. Nick Stonehouse.
Here.
Okay, and who do we have left here? Kelly, where's Kelly?
Here.
Well, Frankie, celebrating Halloween every day does seem like a lot of fun. This is Kelly Sharkey reporting with this month's edition of Rewind Mail Time. See you next month.
Nick Stonehouse is here to fill us in with Oktoberfest with Washington Township German students.
For German students in Washington Township, Oktoberfest is their first chance to practice what they've learned in class. There is plenty of German culture to experience, as the festival offers a balance of learning and recreation. The social gathering has a tendency to draw a large amount of patrons and is very popular among its students. German teacher Herr Anderson explains how the festival benefits his class.
It's fun. I always joke around with the kids. I'm like, oh yeah, let's go. We can hang out and speak German. Like, I make it as a joke, but at the same time, I'm kind of thinking, you know, this is a good chance for you to sharpen your language skills and you know, have fun. I conduct my class completely in German, and my students are very used to that. And I think that they begin to feel more comfortable when you're in a setting outside of the classroom. That's actually the way to obtain real language and real words that may come up in everyday situations. So.
The trip begins with everyone gathering in the core. Then it's off to the bus. Finally, arriving at Collingswood High School, the students are handed a ticket and Oktoberfest begins. First thing to greet students is the food. There is a plethora of German food. Next, a live band plays cultural music, which the students love to dance along to.
Just all the dancing and everything. It's a whole bunch of fun with all the great German music. You don't even need to know how to dance. You can just mess around. It's still just a whole bunch of fun.
Even some students and teachers wear classic German clothing.
Oh. Gotta be in style, right? So
How could you not? I don't know. I think it's very fun, actually, to have, at least have that one time a year when you can sort of show off the German heritage. And so I have my Lederhosen on, and some of the other teachers come from other schools, and they have dirndls on. So it's a lot of fun.
To wind down the night, everyone sits on the floor to participate in one final song. Collingswood's annual Oktoberfest has seen another successful turnout. Students shared their knowledge of German language and culture, but more importantly, they had fun while doing it. Between all the activities and learning, the festival gives students lasting memories. This is Nicholas Stonehouse reporting for Monthly Rewind, Season 15.
2010-2011 ice hockey team is expected to do great things this season. Kelsey Brown tells us about their first half of their successful season.
Washington Township is well known for our sports programs being highly ranked. Football, lacrosse, basketball, and cheerleading are just a few. One sport in particular has caught the attention of many Township students and fans. Ice hockey. The team this season is led by senior captain number 20, Eddie Saren. He has been a part of the hockey program for 4 years. I had the privilege of talking to Eddie about his love for the game and also his thoughts on this year's current season.
Team chemistry is really good right now. It's a good vibe in the locker room and everything. We're coming as a team and we're doing really good together. I feel we definitely will win our league championship, and then we can win the Flyers Cup, which is the best team from South Jersey, Pennsylvania. I feel we can definitely do that.
Even though during games, everyone may have their eye on the team's captain, there are still some key players to watch out for. This year, senior assistant captain, number 23, Mike Cimarelli, plays a big part in the team's competitive edge. He is ready for the responsibility that comes with being assistant captain.
The team looking up to me as assistant captain is like a big goal of mine. I worked for assistant captain since I was like a freshman, basically. It means a lot. I just try to lead them and help them and try to do like what I've done. And they try to follow my path, and they keep a good track record. I keep them in line.
I had the chance to speak with another team member who has also made an impact on the team's success this season. Junior number 4, Kevin Mallow, is certainly a player to watch out for. Starting varsity as a junior, he is definitely a big asset to the team this season.
I think we go pretty far, probably, hopefully championship, you know. We're a good team, good chemistry, so hopefully go far.
After speaking with the boys, I got the chance to speak with the man who holds all the cards, Coach Glick. Being his first year at Township, he's been playing long enough to know exactly what he's talking about.
I played hockey from the time I was about 5 years old. I'm 29, so I've been coaching for a long time. Hopefully, if we can win a championship, that would be obviously the most important accomplishment.
Bringing back memories, the boys talk about what it was like to score their first goal.
Oh my God, it was an amazing experience. Like when you get out there, your first shift, you're just like real scared.
Yeah, the first Clearview game, and when I scored, the whole place blew up, and it was really nice to score that goal.
You can't really explain it. It's just feeling, it's the greatest feeling ever, you know.
So Township, don't stress. The hockey season isn't over yet. There's still time to come out and support the team. From all of us at Rewind, good luck this season, Township. This has been Kelsey Brown reporting for Month of Rewind, Season 15.
Zach Sommerfeld is here to report on the Philadelphia Phillies and their exciting season.
In past years, as the leaves would change colors and summer would become autumn, Philadelphia sports fans' attention would shift from the baseball diamond to the football field. But recently, because of the team's success, fans in the Delaware Valley have kept their focus on the Philadelphia Phillies. For those of us who are teenagers, the Phillies have not been the favorite team in town, but their new winning ways have sparked a lot of interest.
It all goes back to 2007, when the Phillies beat out the Mets and won the first National League Eastern Division Championship in 14 years. Unfortunately, they were eliminated in the first round of the playoffs, falling to the Colorado Rockies in 3 games. The following year, the team repeated the previous year's effort by winning the division. But the 08 campaign didn't stop there. They made it all the way to the World Series, where they defeated the Rays to capture their second World Series championship in franchise history. The 2009 team also returned to the World Series, but unfortunately fell to the New York Yankees.
The 2010 Phillies returned to action this year with some high expectations and some new faces. They made it back to the playoffs by winning their 4th consecutive division title. But is winning the only reason people like the Phillies so much? I caught up with a few WTHS students who were diehard Phillies fans.
I've been a Phillies fan since 93. I mean, pretty much born into a Phillies family, so I've been a Phillies fan ever since. I usually attend about 5 to 6 games. My favorite player is probably Jay Sutley, the guy, probably second baseman ever to play for the Phillies, and hopefully go in the Hall of Fame one day. The best part about this year's team is probably the starting rotation. The 1, 2, and 3 guys, they're probably the best in the major leagues right now.
Been a Phillies fan for about 10 years. Phillies are my favorite professional sports team. Became most interested in Phillies probably around 99 when I got season tickets. And I've been to about 15 games. What I like most about the Phillies is probably their chemistry.
Team chemistry is very important to winning baseball games. And the Phillies have assembled a team that has incredible chemistry. To go with the chemistry, the Phillies have incredible talent at every position. The players they have are a mixture of a strong nucleus of players that have been on the team for years and recent additions acquired to make the team better. This team's success is far from being unnoticed. Year after year, millions of fans pass through the turnstiles to come out and watch the Phillies. But it seems that the support increases as the playoffs approach. I got the guys' opinions on fans that only bring out their Phillies colors come October.
When kids become fans, like during the postseason run, it's one of my pet peeves, and I don't like it.
I think the term bandwagons may be overused a little bit. I mean, in Washington Township, there's a lot of students. A lot of them do jump on the last second. I mean, that's fine if they want to come for the ride, but let's keep it on the DL for, you know, the rest of the season. Hopefully they can maintain that status throughout the whole season.
All good things must come to an end, and the Phillies did not make it all the way to the World Series this year. The guys told me how they felt about the Phillies season coming to an end.
Even though the Phillies lost in the NLCS this year, I think they'll have a better team next year. So.
Tough break we had this NLCS this past week. You know, the Giants came out firing. Their 1-2-3 combo pitching matched ours and was better. It'll be devastating. They lost, you know, second year in a row. But I mean, it's that's sports, and you can't put your whole heart into them, or you'll never get over it.
This year, the Phillies' 2010 playoff run began with them sweeping the Cincinnati Reds and advancing to the National League Championship Series. Unfortunately, they fell to the Giants, but it's sure their success will continue next year because most of the 2010 players will be returning for the 2011 team. This has been Zach Summerfield reporting for Monthly Rewind, Season 15.
And finally, the boys' soccer team is having a successful season. Jess Hagberg tells us more.
Before we know it, the fall sports season will be coming to a close. Many teams are finishing up their last few games or preparing for playoffs. One team that has managed to shine this season is the boys' varsity soccer team. With a record of 9-5-1, it's clear that the boys put in a lot of hard work and dedication. Leadership is very important to the team's success. Senior captains Vinny Virtue and Cameron Scotese are key players as well as great leaders. I had the chance to speak with Vinny about the role he plays as team captain.
Being a captain, I have to, you know, make sure everything's put together well, keep the water filled, sweep the locker room, make any kind of team issues, even outside of the locker room, outside of soccer, I have to make sure it's dealt with. And basically, if any problems occur, it still falls on me and my other captain, Cameron. And we hold a lot of responsibilities with keeping the team together, stuff like that.
Aside from hard work and talent, team chemistry and bonding play a big role in the team's performance. I spoke with some varsity players to find out how the team stays together on and off the field.
All the seniors have like known each other since like for a long time. So we've been playing with each other for a while too, since like sixth grade. And then we have pasta parties at Vince Virtue's house. It's pretty fun. Get ping pong going, some pool.
Yeah, we have really good team chemistry. Everyone likes each other. And we win games together.
Well, we do a lot of different stuff. We have dinners at Olive Garden. We all go to my house. We play ping pong. Just have a good time. We go to the girls' soccer games, go to their senior nights. Just all hang out together as a team. Like, it's always good to have a team bond outside the field as well on the field. It just makes everyone work together better.
Mr. Shane Snyder has been known around Township as the girls' soccer coach. This year, however, he has stepped up to become the boys' varsity head coach. I was able to speak with Mr. Snyder about his new coaching position, as well as his goals and expectations for this year's team.
I guess before the season, our goals were to make the coaches tournament, make the state tournament, and improve every game, and be playing our best soccer at the end of the year. So did we meet the goals so far, and to win the conference? We didn't win the conference. Eastern won the conference, but we did make the state tournament. We did make the coaches tournament. We were hoping to win a game in the coaches tournament. We didn't. We lost 1-0 to Timber Creek, but then we played them again and we beat them. So we're working. It's been different taking over for Mr. Pat. I mean, I was fortunate to coach with Mr. Patterson for 4 years before I went with the girls, and the last 7 years with the girls. So to be the head coach, it's nothing different than the girls. You know, once you're the head coach of a boys or girls program, it's kind of the similar. You know, you have the same responsibilities, the same interactions with the kids, just now you're dealing with boys instead of girls.
Mr. Snyder has proven himself more than qualified to run such an established soccer program. But how do the players feel about their new coach?
He's a good guy, just like real fun. He really changed the culture very well for our team. It's what we needed coming from last year. And he really turned us around, made us into a lot better of a team.
I think we get along real well. We have our ups and downs though, but overall, we're pretty good.
The season is winding down, but there's still time to come out and support the boys' soccer team. Good luck with the rest of your season, boys. For Monthly Rewind Season 15, I'm Jessica Hagberg.
That's all for this month.
Tune in next month.
And every month for more Monthly Rewind Season 15.
Happy Halloween!
That doesn't make sense. It's not the way it was supposed to be. And look, the season.
I'm here at Collingswood High School, where many students have gathered for a German celebration of culture.
I'm gonna say, oh look, we got some mail.
I'm sorry, hold it up a little bit higher. Thank you. Over y'all.
Take 7,081. The Reds and the Blues have clashed for years, but the team has always. Give me a paper.
Next chapter.
This is ridiculous. I've done this 5,000 times and I still can't get it right. The Reds and the Blues have clashed for years, but both sides have waited for the time that they can become one team. It has been. Look, I can't even say it right. What is it?